The Kaman SH-2F Seasprite can be said to be among the most successful off-the-shelf solutions of the Cold War. This light, versatile helicopter, developed from an air rescue model, came to be a vital asset to the surface fleet, both as a means of defense and surveillance, while remaining a reliable workhorse capable of everything from search and rescue to hauling cargo. While helicopters had undergone considerable development since the first usable designs had been conceived in the 1920s, they remained a clumsy novelty into the 1940s. It wasn't until Igor Sikorsky developed the R-4 that a robust and reliable design reached mass production. In all, several dozen R-4s would be delivered to the Coast Guard and Navy, where they took part in a number of rescue missions across North America and the Pacific. Sikorsky would continue to capitalize on this over the coming decade with their heavy H-19 and H-34 helicopters. Entering service in the early 50s, these helicopters were all metal and equipped with heavy radial engines. In civilian and military service, they would prove exceptional, capable of airlifting cargo to otherwise unreachable areas. The next major innovation would be swapping the heavy radial engine for a geared turbine. The turbine provided a far better power-to-weight ratio than the radial engines, and it was compact, allowing it to be placed at the center of the helicopter, and thus avoided the forward engine placement that made some earlier helicopters nose-heavy. From then on, it was clear that turbine power would be the future of helicopter design. In the US, the first experiments for this type of helicopter propulsion were pioneered by Charles Kaman's aircraft company. The first successful experiment was achieved through combining the Boeing 502 turbine with his company's K225. Kaman, a former employee of Sikorsky, would develop this new helicopter along with his head designer, Anton Flettner, a German engineer who pioneered the use of intermeshing rotors. The experimental K225 proved promising enough to warrant further development, and soon, the Kaman Aircraft Company would produce a new utility helicopter along its lines. The firm's HH-43 Husky firefighting and rescue helicopter fit the bill, and its later models were equipped with turboshaft engines in the late 50s. However, the firm's greatest success was soon to arrive, as the Navy sent out a request for a new carrier-borne lightweight helicopter. The US Navy's request for a light multipurpose and rescue helicopter was soon met with Kaman's newest design, the Kaman Seasprite. The helicopter would settle the requirements, being capable of carrying up to 12 people, remaining compact and fuel-efficient, and taking up little space aboard aircraft carriers. In the 1956 competition, Kaman's design won handily, and the next year saw a contract issued for procurement. The helicopter was the first Kaman design to feature a single main rotor, and in conjunction with the servo-flap rotor system, it was cutting-edge, reliable, and possessed smooth flight characteristics. The design, then named HU-2K, first flew on July 2, 1959, and was introduced fully in December 1962. It proved to be robust with good handling. However, the single General Electric T-58 GE turbine left it fairly underpowered. This prevented it from taking on any new missions, but it was sufficient for the basic role it was designed for. These helicopters, later designated UH-2A and UH-2B, though largely identical, were produced until 1965, with a total of 142 airframes built. The Seasprites, supplied to utility helicopter squadrons, were distributed amongst US aircraft carriers and saw widespread use during the Vietnam War. There, they served largely as plane guards, where they took up a position alongside aircraft carriers when air operations were underway. In case of an accident during takeoff or landing, the Seasprites would move in quickly to recover downed pilots. Search and rescue also fell under their purview, and alongside a number of other models, they pulled hundreds of airmen from the sea. As fleet utility helicopters, they also flew ashore and between various vessels in order to transfer personnel and equipment. Medical evacuations were also among tasks these helicopters performed, moving injured personnel to ships with more substantial medical facilities. The small size and smooth controls of the Seasprite made landing on the basic helicopter facilities of most ships an easier affair compared to the bulkier Sikorsky Sea King. Its only drawback was the relatively little power offered by its small turbine engine. It could make for tricky takeoffs, as a small helicopter was slow to climb. In spite of it being underpowered, it proved to be a valuable asset to the fleet and was respected by its pilots. Naturally, the Navy wished for improved models. Kaman's first move was to add a second turbine engine to the helicopter, the improved model being the UH-2C. As the production run had already been completed, the Navy sent the older A and B models back to the company in order to receive the upgrade. The C model was introduced in 1966, though now with its much higher speed and carrying capacity, it was soon deemed that the Seasprite was to take on a much wider scope of duties. During the late 60s, the increased threat posed by ever more advanced models of submarines was of great concern to the US surface fleet. Even more concerning was a lack of long-range anti-submarine weapons. While many anti-submarine vessels did carry the ASROC missile, tipped with either a nuclear depth charge or a Mark 46 torpedo, there was some concern of submarines attacking from beyond the range of this weapon. The existing long-range anti-submarine weapon was the Gyrodyne Dash Drone, a small drone helicopter capable of carrying depth charges and torpedoes. While it was compact, it was inflexible and had no means of collecting additional data in the area of the suspected submarine. This left most of the US Navy's light surface forces, which often operated too far from the carrier to be covered by its airborne ASW umbrella, under threat from more modern submarines. The solution was found in the re-engined Seasprite. The new SH-2D represented the greatest change thus far, with the new aircraft sporting a chin-mounted surface search radar, a rack to carry a Mark 46 lightweight torpedo, and a 15-chute sonobuoy rack. The performance of the helicopter and its ability to operate on nearly every major surface combatant would see this mission expanded even further. Thus came the Light Airborne Multipurpose System, or LAMPS, a fleet-wide program to equip most warships with helicopters in order to boost their anti-submarine and anti-surface capabilities. LAMPS 1 would place a now standardized SH-2F aboard nearly every frigate, destroyer, and cruiser in the fleet. In addition to the long-standing utility missions, the helicopters were data-linked to their host ship to allow them to prosecute possible submarine contacts, provide long-range surface surveillance, and allow for more effective over-the-horizon targeting of enemy surface threats. The new SH-2F was largely the same as the preceding UH-2D model. Though it standardized the use of composite rotor blades and its tail wheel was moved forward to enable it to better operate off of smaller ships, some 85 Seasprites were converted to this type, and a further 48 were produced in the early 80s in order to cover a shortfall before the introduction of the SH-60B Seahawk. The new standard LAMPS helicopter entered service in 1974. The LAMPS 1 program vastly increased the offensive and surveillance capabilities of participating vessels. This encompassed some half dozen ship classes, ranging from the workhorse frigates of the fleet, such as the Knox and Oliver Hazard Perry, to the nuclear-guided missile cruiser USS Truxtun. In the anti-submarine mission, on detecting a suspected submarine, the ship would launch its SH-2F. Capable of using sensor data from the ship, the helicopter would move in and begin to deploy its sonobuoys. The helicopter then relayed the sonobuoy data back to the ship for processing. and if the contact was found and classified, the helicopter would move in to confirm its location and attack. In the anti-submarine role, the helicopter was a largely reactive measure, as it was unable to process its own sonobuoy data and lacked a dipping sonar, and thus required other platforms to detect the submarine first. This is not to say it lacked considerable offensive potential, as the powerful hull-mounted sonar arrays aboard the Knox-class frigates and Spruance-class destroyers, and the Oliver Hazard Perry short-range but highly sensitive sonar, were among the most advanced systems of their kind. The presence of the helicopter thus allowed ships to prosecute, classify, and engage submerged contacts that would otherwise be beyond the effective range of their sensors and weapons. In addition to the added anti-submarine mission, the Seasprite performed anti-surface support and anti-ship missile defense roles. In performing these missions, the Seasprite used its search radar to track and identify potentially hostile surface vessels. This allowed the host vessel to build a picture of enemy forces while putting itself in comparatively little danger. With this information, any LAMS-1 vessel had early warning against potentially hostile surface vessels, and could also use the relayed information to more accurately fire harpoon missiles over the horizon without using its own radar and revealing itself. The extended surveillance range of a LAMS vessel was pushed beyond 170 miles with the use of the Seasprite. LAMS-1 thoroughly improved the anti-submarine and anti-surface capability of much of the US fleet, with the Seasprite itself being an almost perfect off-the-shelf solution. While there were limitations, like the inability to perform an independent sonar search, the overall benefit of the ship not needing to prosecute subsurface contacts alone, or having to refuel itself to perform a radar search in its patrol area, was well worth the resources devoted to the Seasprite. By the end of the Cold War, the Seasprite had incorporated a number of improvements. These comprised a number of onboard and weapon systems, perhaps most notably, the introduction of the Mark 46 Mod 5 or near-tip lightweight torpedo. The new model was designed to counter the latest advancements in Soviet nuclear submarine design, with the torpedo possessing an improved engine to make for a higher speed, an improved sonar transducer to increase the effective detection range of the weapon and add better countermeasure resistance, and had a new guidance and control group. The new weapon entered service in 1979, with kits being produced to convert old stocks to the new standard. An improved model of the helicopter equipped with T-700 GE-401 engines was also developed in 1985, though few of the Super Seasprites were procured, as the Navy sought to increase supplies of the SH-60 Seahawk. Some of the improvements from the scaled-back Super Seasprite did, however, make their way into the SH-2F. During the mid-80s, a number of LAMS-1 helicopters were equipped with flare pods for IR searches, IR jammers, chaff and flare dispenser, and an infrared sea mine detection system. Their service during the Gulf War saw them mostly perform ship-to-ship material and personnel transfers, mine detection, and medical evacuation roles, as Iraq possessed no submarines. Their primary mission in the theater was mine hunting duties, for which they used IR sensors in their search. After almost 30 years of service, the SH-2F was withdrawn along with most of the vessels that carried them. The Navy would fully transition over to the Sikorsky Seahawk, a much larger and more powerful helicopter which carried two or more torpedoes, a dipping sonar, and incorporated sonobuoy processing capabilities. The Kaman Seasprite can be said to be among the most versatile aircraft ever operated by the US Navy. Entering service as a plain guard, the number of roles it served grew considerably over the years to encompass everything from medical evacuation to anti-submarine duties. As the core of the LAMS program for nearly 10 years, It gave US warship a boost in their offensive and defensive qualities against both surface and subsurface opponents. And that concludes our look at the Sea Sprite, the little helicopter that could do quite a lot. Until next time, don't forget to subscribe and check out our website. The articles there are larger versions of what we present on YouTube.